In 1607, the colony at Jamestown was founded. The Virginia Company, named for Queen Elizabeth, the Virgin Queen. It had a terrible history, if you study the history of Jamestown. But in the same year that Jamestown was founded, there was a group of separatists who left England and went to Holland because of religious persecution. They settled in a town in Holland called Leyden. They were known as Leydenites. It was that same group that in 1619 felt like that God was calling them to this new world. They left Holland and came to England. They had two ships that were commissioned, the Mayflower and the Speedwell. They had over 200 people that they were going to bring to the new world. They were coming as pilgrims to seek a new land for themselves and for the propagation of the gospel. Well, as you know, in August when they set sail from England, the Speedwell became known as Sinkwell. The ship broke apart. Well, they had to go back. So they went back and had several weeks of delays where they ate up most of their groceries. Finally, they decided the Speedwell was not going to make it. This was providential because about half of the people going were going on a financial venture and not because of spiritual things. Well, when they had to cut down to one ship, and by the way, the Mayflower is the size of a volleyball court. All right, think of a volleyball court. That's the size of that ship. There were 102 pilgrims on that ship. They never came above deck. One guy did, a guy named John Howland. John, he just couldn't take that puke anymore or whatever, you know. And excuse me, he couldn't take the conditions down there. And it was the North Atlantic, and man, they had everything closed down. Can you imagine being with 102 people in a space smaller than a volleyball court for 66 days where nobody opened the hatch and let any air come in? That'd be a blessing. You talk about right guard, son. I guarantee you'd need left guard and everything else. And remember the story of John Howland. By the way, John Howland lived to be older than any other man. He was the last original pilgrim to die. But he almost died going over. He couldn't take it anymore, and so he burst up through there and got on deck. And what he didn't realize was he was right in the middle of a storm. And about the time he hit the deck, the ship moved, and he wasn't there anymore. He was over the side. And he cried out to God and stuck his hand up, and wouldn't you know it, the ship was leaning so far over, one of the ropes from one of the sails went by his arm and he caught it. And they ultimately drug him back on board. Now you talk about, again, the providence of God in John Howland's life. But they were just past the halfway point. 102. By the way, they had a baby born on that trip. They had one man die, a guy named Mr. Button. He died because he wouldn't drink the lemon juice. He didn't like the taste of it, and he got scurvy and croaked. But and the other guy that died was the guy that cussed the pilgrims all the time, and God just killed him. He got sick and died. Nobody else on the ship even got sick. And sailors always worried about that, because when you have an epidemic with 102 people stuck together in a place the size of a volleyball court, disease can run pretty rampant. It was not unusual for half the people on a ship like that to die. But Mr. Button died because he wouldn't drink the lemon juice, and then old Badmouth died because he cussed the pilgrims, and then had a baby born. So anyway, but they're about halfway. They just passed the point of sort of no return, and they were in a bad storm, and the main sail was anchored by this huge beam, and that thing broke, which meant they could not stabilize the mainsail. I mean, the mast just would not stabilize. And they didn't know what they were going to do. And the captain said, we're going to have to go back because they had better winds going back. And the people had insisted on bringing a printing press. And the printing press had this big screw thing that pushed it down on there and made the impression. They took the printing press and used it as a device to bring that spar right back up there. And they wedged the printing press and they twisted that screw on there until they got it in place, and that held it until they got to Massachusetts. Can you believe that? Again, the providence of God. Well, and by the way, the captain of the ship's first name was Christopher. His last name was Jones, but his first name was Christ-bearer on the Mayflower. They come over, and they get blown off course. When they finally see land, they realize they are not where they thought they were going to be. They are not in the Virginia Company territory. So the captain, Christopher Jones, says, "We're going to sail south." He tried three times. He never could go because of the storm that kept pushing them back. They finally said, "Maybe God wants us here." Duh. Now, there was a problem. They were about to set foot on land that had no dominion. Nobody was in charge. What do you do? And so they gathered together in the hold of that ship, and they drew up an article. We call it the Mayflower Compact. It was adopted on November the 11th, 1620. A couple of y'all were there. I'm going to read some of this. This was the foundation of the Declaration of Independence, by the way. "In the name of God, amen. We whose names are underwritten, the loyal subjects of our dread sovereign Lord King James, by the grace of God of Great Britain, France, Ireland, King, Defender of the Faith, etc., having undertaken for the glory of God and the advancement of the Christian faith and honor of our king and country, a voyage to plant the first colony in the northern parts of Virginia, do by these presents solemnly and mutually in the presence of God and of one another, covenant and combine ourselves together in a civil body politic for our better ordering and preservation and furtherance of the ends aforesaid, and by virtue hereof to enact, constitute, frame such just and equal laws, ordinances, acts, constitutions, and offices from time to time as shall be thought most meet and convenient for the general good of the colony, unto which we promise all due submission and obedience, in witness whereof we have hereunder subscribed our names at Cape Cod, the 11th of November, in the year of the reign of our sovereign King James of England, Anno Domini 1620. That document was the basis of the Declaration of Independence and later the Constitution. It was drawn up on the Mayflower prior to their landing at what became the Plymouth Colony.